नमस्ते एंड वेलकम टू दिस एक्साइटिंग एपिसोड ऑफ सत्तोलॉजी डीबंकिंग मिथोलॉजी। सत मीन्स ट्रूथ, लोगोस मीन्स स्टडी ऑफ साइंस, सत्तोलॉजी मीन्स साइंस ऑफ ट्रूथ, स्टडी ऑफ ट्रूथ, एंड मिथोलॉजी मीन्स साइंस ऑफ फेक लाइ इमेजिनेशन, स्टडी ऑफ फेक लाइ इमेजिनेशन। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू टॉक अबाउट अ वेरी स्पेशल गेस्ट। ही इज अ ट्रैवलर एंड ही टेल्स स्टोरीज थ्रू फोटोग्राफ्स। And we're going to touch upon a very important photograph from Purana. And let us introduce Sri Rajesh Kumar Singh. Namaste, Rajesh ji.
Namaste, Aditya ji. And namaste to all my learned friends and audience. As usual, it's my pleasure to interact with all of you. And
before you start off, I want to ask you something. So when we mention about Purana, and when we mention about Purana, people generally refer to that as a mythology, something not real. But I want to clarify for the audience that Purana may have histories from other planets also, not just from this planet. But, you know, like I give a logic of, if there are 10 things true in the Purana, and 11th thing you do not understand. So the point is that if the 10 things were true and one I could not understand, the one I could not understand must be true, but it's not in my experience. What do you have to say on that?
See, what I have to say is this, that these are the creations of excellence of human creativity. Mm-hmm. And those who have not created much, they have tried to subvert these knowledge system, and they said that this is mythology. I mean, when we will discuss this, you will see that whatever has been talked about, the type of questions which have been asked and about our existence, after all, science has not been able to understand fully why do we come here and where do we go.
Exactly.
So these questions have been intensively examined throughout Indian civilization, and those have happened in Purana also. And as you said, that a bit of them we would have understood, and those which have not been understood, we cannot say that didn't exist or it's false.
Exactly. So please go ahead. Please go ahead.
So, dear friends, today I'll be talking about a very important legend which exists in our Puranas. There are 18 Puranas, Ashtadash Puranas, Puran, and one of them is Bhagavat Puran, a Puran where different tales of Vishnu and his devotees has been talked about. So in one of the chapters, that is chapter Skand 8th chapter, there is a tale of Gajendra Mohj. Now, those of you who know Sanskrit a bit, Gaj means elephant in Sanskrit. And if you see in Indian art, you will see very popularly in the figure one, you see that there is an elephant whose left leg has been caught by a crocodile. And Bhagwan Vishnu rushes towards him to save him. And he offers a lotus to his god, his Bhagwan, that is Vishnu. And Garuna is also trying to help in that. And on the right side, you can see that this theme has been influencing the Indian mind as it has been doing throughout the ages. And there is a modern depiction of Vishnu and the elephant almost merge between themselves. It shows that the Gaj, which is elephant, has immersed deep into meditation and prayer and is reaching towards God. Now, this is a theme which you can see in many places. When you travel in India, worldwide, in India, art, architecture, sculpture, dance, drama, songs, they all have talked about, depicted their culture, and Gajendra Moksha is also one of the themes which has been widely depicted. One of the independent paintings that is there in Brooklyn Museum in New York, where you can see, again here you can see, there's a white elephant which is caught by what we call makar or magarmaksh or gra, that is crocodile. And then there are different elephants which form the family of this elephant, Gajendra, who is nothing but, he was a king in his past birth, Indradyumna. And when he prays here also, you can see he's offering a lotus. God Vishnu or Lord Vishnu has left his vehicle, Garuda, and he's rushing towards him to shave him. Similarly, another painting on the same theme you can see in San Diego Museum of Art in California. Of course, it was produced here in 19th century. And here again, you can see Garuda and Vishnu mounting his vehicle, Garuda, and Vishnu is here, Lord Vishnu, and different gods, goddesses are seeing this important aspect. The Gajendra, that is King Gaj, has become quite weak because he has been caught by a crocodile and is not able to rescue himself out of this tricky situation. And when his family members see that now they cannot help, they tried in the initial time, but as you know, that crocodile lives in the water, so it's very strong and the hold is very strong, so they cannot rescue the Gaj or the elephant from the hold of crocodile. So they are leaving now. So Gajendra, that is the elephant, has no other choice but to pray. And that's what he did. So he starts praying to the Lord or the Bhagwan Vishnu. And this is very important to understand here, that in Indian tradition or Indian philosophical thinking, it's not only human who can reach to God and can attain moksha. Anybody can do, any jeev atma, anybody, any creature which has come to the earth can pray to the God and achieve the highest supreme consciousness, which is the state of the Godness. And this is a universal theme. It's not restricted to India only. And here, similarly, if you go to different museums in India, you can see the paintings which were created here. So here I have taken a museum from a very famous city in Karnataka, Bangalore. Most of you must be aware, it's a hub of many software companies, Infosys, Wipro, and many others. But at the same time, art and culture have thrived in India in different parts. So here there is a modern building, British period, but it houses a lot of sculptures, and at the second floor, a lot of paintings are displayed here. One of the paintings depicts Gajendra Moksha. So the theme remains same. However, depending on the period, depending on the location where it has been drawn, the dress and depiction changes. Here also you see crocodile, and it has caught hold of the Gajendra. And then when God with Lakshmi, Bhagwan Vishnu and Lakshmi are there, Garuda is here, they come here, they rescue the Gajendra. Then you see they convert into two divine people. Another example which I'll show you. Is in Gujarat state, in Vadodara district. So it was not only in as an independent paintings, but even in the mansions or the residences where rich people would live, they would decorate their houses with a lot of paintings which were drawn from their ancestral history, whether it was Ramayana or Mahabharata or tales from the Bhagavad Purana. And one of the tales again has been depicted on this wall, you can see, through mural painting. And of course, it differs in depiction depending on the style where it has been carved out, but the theme remains same. You see a crocodile here, again holding Gaj with his family. He is offering a lotus to Lord Vishnu, who has descended from his mount, and he is rescuing him. Another example of a palace depicting is in Orcha. Orcha is a very famous place near Khajuraho. Many of the tourists do come there, and few of you would have been there. So there also you see these palaces, they are beautifully painted. And one of the themes here, the same Gajendra there, Garuda is rushing and to reach here, but Lord Vishnu doesn't want to wait to rescue his devotee who has been worshipping him intentionally, and he leaves Garuda and descends down and rescues him. So we saw these depictions in Gujarat and in Orcha in Madhya Pradesh in central India. And in the far southern state of Kerala, there is a temple which belongs to Rama in Tirupayur, in Rama, in Thrissur district in Kerala. And there, when you go inside the temple, there is a circular temple. And because it rains heavily in Kerala, so of course here you can see a shade has been provided to protect the temple and their paintings. So this circular wall has been carved beautifully with paintings which have been drawn, taking inspiration or the themes from Mahabharata, Ramayana, and Bhagavata Purana. And here again, you can see that this panel depicts the story of the Gajendra Moksha. The elephant is here. You can see from the arrow, which has been caught by the crocodile. And Lord Vishnu, with all his attributes, is resting on the Garuda, his vehicle, and when he saved the Gajendra from his animal form, here on the right panel, Lord Vishnu and the King Indradyumna, which actually has got converted into another birth into an elephant, has been rescued, and now God is taking him to his own abode with him. Means taking to his own abode means he reaches to the supreme consciousness. Means anybody can reach to that level with his prayer, with devotion, when they get detached from the daily course or the daily issues which keep them caught in the web of the sansar, which we call that is universe. So not only in paintings, but in carvings also, in temples. When you travel in India, you'll see the temples have been profusely carved. They are not without any purpose. There is a purpose there to educate people, to tell them about the good things which are there in our history, in Ramayana, Mahabharata, and here Bhagavad Purana, so that people, when they go in these holy places, pious places, when they move around, they learn about, the generations would learn, the elder people would tell students about, their children about them. And then they would get inspired from these tales, and they would like to imbibe these qualities in themselves. So here, it's a Hoysaleswara temple dedicated to Shiva, but panels belonging to Vishnu and other gods and goddesses are also profusely depicted. So there is no distinction that Shiva temple will have only idols which would tell about Shiva and his family. It's not. It's a unified universe of supreme consciousness, as I have talked about it earlier also, that in Sanatana Dharma, in our tradition, the supreme consciousness is represented by Brahma, Vishnu, and Mahesh, that is Shiva, and all of them are carved together. In some places, some devotee would like to pray a god with more passion. So he or she is allowed for that. There's no restriction. So depending on where the place is there, which devotee is there, and what kind of ruler was there, you will find emphasis on certain aspects of the supreme consciousness. But there has been a connect. You will find that all those important tales, all those important themes have been depicted in different parts of the country. And that gives a cultural connect amongst the people, wherever they belong to. Now, if I go to Karnataka and see this theme, and I don't understand the language of that state, Kannada, I do understand Hindi and English, and I don't understand Kannada, but when I go to this temple, I fully connect with it. It's not that I'm detached, because I know these stories and the way they have been carved and they have been depicted, it shows not only skill, but devotion and the passion through which it has been done. So this is the beauty of the Indian heritage, that our forefathers have given us a lot of philosophical jewels, and we have tried to preserve them through manifestation in art and architecture. And here I had shown you some paintings. And in this particular instance, you can see the sculptural art beautifully carved. Here, this crocodile is there who has caught this leg of Gajendra, who turns back in despair and offers a lotus to Bhagwan Vishnu, who descends on Garuda and saves him through a chakra. You can see the chakra here, thrown by or aimed by Bhagwan Vishnu to rescue the Gajendra. Now, the earlier temple which I had shown you, this one, it dates to 10th century, and the paintings, they are quite recent, 18th century, 19th century, and some of them in 20th century, at least poster arts has been done in 20th century, and modern art you can see in 21st century. But the earliest form which you can see is in Devgarh. Devgarh, I have talked about it earlier also, is in Uttar Pradesh, just at the border of Madhya Pradesh in Lalitpur district, and there is a temple dedicated to Lord Vishnu. It is known as Dasavatar temple because there were a lot of carvings related to Lord Vishnu and his avatar, that is incarnations, were there. And there are three panels on the three sides on the wall in the niches, and one of them represent Gajendra Moksha. So here you can see again Gajendra caught in the web of the coils of a serpent king. Here there is a difference. It's not crocodile, but the naga is there. The serpent with his queen is there. So it's a symbolic representation that if a human being, a human creature, is caught in the day-to-day affair of the world, and he's not able to get peace or get out of those things, so he has a way to get out of it, and that is nothing but a prayer. And there you don't want necessarily a guide to teach you. If you are detached and you directly connect with the supreme consciousness, as Gajendra did, God will come, Lord will come and will liberate you. In Indian consciousness, in Indian tradition, any human being, as a man or woman, shall achieve four aims: dharma, artha, kama, moksha. Dharma is righteousness. Whatever behavior shall be there, you shall follow the path of righteousness. And then kam means ichcha. Ichcha means desire. So everybody has a desire. We all have a desire to have, to achieve some post, to do something in life. And that is, that helps in upbringing. I mean, we create. And then earth is wealth. So you have to earn wealth to take care of yourself, your family, your parents. But ultimately, we don't know why we come on earth and why do we go. So while you take birth and do all your actions, you shall follow the path of righteousness. That is dharma. You do have kamana, that is desire, but you shall control it and you shall earn wealth through righteousness. But ultimately, everybody has to depart from this earth. And nobody knows where do we all be go. But Indian tradition, in Indian tradition, we find this aspect have been examined in detail time and again. In Upanishads, you will find in Ramayana, in Mahabharata, there are a lot of stories, there are a lot of preachings which examine these questions that has happened in Veda. So in Gajendra Moksha also, what is being emphasized is that ultimately anybody who is caught in a situation from where one has to get out, and it can be any creature, not restricted only to a man or woman, but any animal, and they can directly connect to the Supreme Consciousness, which is manifested in a form which they believe in. It's not that in Indian tradition, we have so many gods and goddesses, because here we have this liberty to pray the way we want. The only thing is that it shall not hurt anybody else. It's not like some of the other belief system where we think that whatever we preach, whatever we believe in is the only right way, and those who don't believe the way we believe in, they are wrong. It's not there. And that's why you find so many gods and goddesses. Because Sanatan Dharma, the Indian tradition, ancient Indian culture has given full liberty to everybody to pray, to create, to give outburst to their creative energy in a way they want. Only condition is that it shall not hurt anybody else in any way. Tulsidas, the great saint, who has written Ramcharitmanas, the story of the Rama in medieval period, he says that parahit saras dharma nahi bhai, par pida sam nahi adhamai. Parahit means others benefit. So there is nothing better than helping others or welfare of others, and there is nothing bad or worse than causing damage to others. So this is the philosophy which we have imbibed, and we have tried to create an environment through our scriptures, through our art and culture, through our temples, thought processes, that everybody shall survive. Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam means Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam. The world is like a family, and sarve bhavantu sukhina, everybody shall be happy. So that is what is there. And one aspect, one path is that, like Bhagwan Krishna has talked about in Gita, is bhakti marg, that is a path of priya, devotion, worship, karma, path of action, and gyan marg, that is path of knowledge. So out of the three, human being is free to choose any one of them. And what Gajendra did, Gajendra was a knowledgeable king. He turned into an elephant because once he was praying in isolation, and Sage Agastya had come there and he asked questions from king, but king was so deeply immersed in his prayer to the God that he could not notice Sage Agastya. And when Sage Agastya saw that this king is not responding to me. Then he cursed him. He gave a strap and he cursed him that since you are sitting like a big person, you are not even moving to receive me, though the king was not aware of this. So you will turn into an elephant. And it shows that what it means is that even if you have achieved with your kamna a lot of wealth, ultimately you have to get detached with all these things to attain moksha or liberation. And Bhagwan will come, Lord will come, if you pray with your devotion. Now, Gajendra Moksha is not about stories. What we were seeing till now is a depiction. And as you told that in Indian tradition, whenever temples are built, stupas were built, mansions were built, residences were built, palaces were built. And in different parts, in Rajasthan, in Sikhauti area, even in modern times, a lot of havelis have been built, big residences have been built, and they have been profusely painted. So it's in our genes, in culture, that you depict these themes so that your generations which follow you, you transfer these good things which have been transferred to us from our forefather, from generations to generation. Now there are 33 slokas or stutis, means prayer themes, which are there. And one of them is Om Namo Bhagavate Tasmai Yat Etad Chita Atmakam Purushaya Dibijaya Parishaya Vidhimahi Yasmin Nidam Yatasya Idam Enidam Yaidam Swayam Yo Asmat Parasmatcha Parastam Prapadde Swayam Bhuvam. So this is the actual prayer which is there. Of course, Sage Sukh is telling the story, the tale of the Gajendra to King Parikshit. And he says that all those stories, tales which I have told you, that how Indradyumna king was cursed by the sage Agastya and then turns into an elephant. And then one day when he goes with his family to enjoy themselves in a pond, and when everybody has carefully taken out by the king, but when he remains there, the last one to come out, the grahi or the magar or the crocodile which was waiting, he caught him. So now it's not that the story is there, actual prayer has been given, and this is the first slope. Om Namo Bhagavate Tasmai, I pray to that Lord, which is true representation by Om. Om in our system is nothing but the true representation of the Supreme Consciousness. Aksharam hi idam Brahma. In Mandukya Upanishad, there are a lot of Upanishad. In Mandukya Upanishad, it is said, Akshar Om. Iti etada aksharam hi idam brahma. Om, this syllable is Brahma. Brahma means supreme consciousness. So the same philosophy you see, even an animal, a human being, which sages have given long back, is again practiced by a devotee. So I pray Om Namo Bhagavate Tasmai, I pray to him, yat etat chidatmakam, which is the source of this universe, purushayadi bijaya, the purush, in our system we say that purush and prakriti, there are two aspects of the same Brahma, supreme consciousness. So that seed, that is bees, manifests yasmin idam, which is inside it, yatascha idam enidam, ya idam swayam. He manifests, he or she. I mean, when we talk about the supreme consciousness, we both have male and female perception as per our understanding. So he is Because he is the manifestation of that supreme energy and he is detached also. So I pray to such kind of God. So it means, and there are, then Gajendra goes on praying, describing the various characteristics which he can perceive. He says, you are formless. Oh Lord, you are formless. If I can't see you, it is my weakness. But do come, save me, rescue me from this situation. In the form, do come in the form which I can visualize. Though you manifest in all forms in the world, and what is not manifested is also part of it. In again Upanishad, there is a slok, Purnamidam Purnat Purnam Adaya Purnameva Avasishyate. So like infinite system, if you take something out of it, Purnamidam Eva, it's complete. If you take something from completeness, it remains complete. So that is the supreme consciousness. And that manifests what we see, that's also representation of God. What we don't see is also manifestation of God. But here you see the kind of prayer Gajendra does. And it's not that only Gajendra does. It's the philosophical cream, the cream of the thought processes which we have seen in Veda, Upanishad, has been transferred to us in this prayer. So there are 33 of them, and it is said in the end that if you recite this again and again, you'll attain oneness with God. You'll attain moksha later on. Now what it means, you have to recite it again and again. It doesn't mean that simply reading will help you in achieving moksha. When you recite it, you start understanding the feeling. You have experiential achievement. You experience it. It's not that somebody has said that God is there, God is not there, and you have to believe or you don't have to believe. You have to experience it. And when you read it, you understand it, you pray to the God, you connect to him, you'll see that you are being transformed. And then when your soul leaves your body, it would reach and get submerged into that supreme consciousness. Now in the last, Gajendra say, Jiji vise na haham iha muya, kimantaram bahischa vrittaye bhayonya, ikchami kalena nayasya, viplavahatasyatmak lokavaranasya mokshamah. Hey Prabhu, hey Bhagwan, oh God, now kindly, I have enjoyed everything in the life, but now I want to achieve salvation, and kindly help me in achieving moksha. Take me to your own abode. And in the two representation, in the other representation also, you will see that nobody is actually bad. God, that's what we believe, that it is because of our karma, action, we do wrong things. Then, of course, we have to bear the result of that, the fruit of that. Karmani va adhikarate ma phalesu kadachana. That's what Bhagavan Sri Krishna says in Gita. So here you see, when Bhagavan Vishnu has got down, and all other gods and goddesses are there, Lord Shiva also, you can see in this depiction, God is with Devi Lakshmi. Both of them, here you see two persons standing beside the God, and here also you see them transforming. The elephant turns into Indradumna, and the crocodile is turning into Huhu. He is also turning into man. So all souls would get liberated if they connect with Bhagwan, the Ishwar, the Supreme Consciousness. Thank you very much.
What an amazing presentation, Rajeshji. And very, you know, and I really liked your reading the quotes from the Bhagavad Puran. You know, and also you spoke the right shlokas. It's in the 8th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam or 8th skand of Srimad Bhagavatam. People can read it. Very liberating stories. And also Indradumna, the person who became Gajendra. And one thing it also shows that the good deeds of the past life are never forgotten, especially the Vedic mantra. So you may, you know, that is the beauty of the Vedic culture, is that if you have done something good, the prayers, they automatically come to you. This is one incident I can say. And also very specifically mentioned, Save Purvam Bhud Raja Pandya Darvida Sattama Indradumna Iti Khyato Vishnu Vrata Parayana. So the Indradumna was the king of the Pandya kingdom. He was the king of the Pandyas, which is ruled the entire south, you can say, south of Vishakhapatnam to Simaladesh, which is called Sri Lanka today. And so it's a historical event. But at the same time, one very interesting struck out that when he said those prayers from his last life, no other devata came except Vishnu, because he called for the supreme person. So then Bhagawan himself came down. What do you have to say on that?
What I have to say is that God comes to anybody who calls with true belief. So there is nobody has to help somebody. I mean, anybody can reach with his right prayer to the God directly. There is no meditation is required. Mediation is not required in between. And that kind of, you can say facility is there in Sanatana Dharma, that God listens to each and every creature because he is omnipresent. So just you have to reach to him. I mean, you have to dissolve all your coverings which we acquire over period, this ego, falsehood about ourselves. Ultimately, everybody has to leave all these things and go. Yeah. So if with true spirit you call God, God do come. And that's what in the representation you can see, not only he comes, he can't wait to come. He leaves Garuda and he just gets down that and he moves that. Even Garuda, who moves so fast, I mean, with the speed of the thought process, God is not able to wait for Garuda to take even a little bit of time, and he reaches very quickly. I mean, almost immediately he reaches there.
And one thing also shows that Bhagwan, you know, I hate to word the use the word Lord or God for Bhagwan, but you can call him Dev or Bhagwan is a better word, Dev. So when we also see that only in Sanatan Dharma or Hindutva or Hinduism, whatever you call it, whichever one you like to call it, there is a direct references of Bhagwan saving a child in the case of Narsingadev, in the reference saving an animal, which is Gajendra, if you want to look at it in that way. And also a human beings, which is very common. So the point is there is a direct intervention, and here, if an animal can attain the success, what to speak of the human being? You know, even though he remembered from his past life, all this, yes, you're saying something, please, Ed.
Yeah, he remembers from the past life. As you said, that we believe that people take birth again and again till they attain moksha. That's what we believe in, because we have come out of the supreme consciousness and we have to reach there. So, for God, all the creatures have been created by him. I mean, that's what we believe in. And that's why you see all the mounts of the gods and goddesses are animals, birds, even Garuda you see here. So, there is not much of distinction. Only thing that maybe in our perception, we feel that the men and women human beings have higher capacity as compared to other animals. Maybe these animals would think that, like, we cannot listen to ultra those frequencies which are out of 20 hertz and 20,000 hertz. We can hear only those frequencies which falls in between. But there are many animals which can listen to the voices, which are sounds which are generated out of these frequencies. So whatever indriyas we have, from that we can perceive a part of the Supreme Consciousness. So we shall not acquire ego in any sense, and we shall not hurt anybody else, because God has created everybody. Of course, if somebody harms you to protect, you have to. You cannot be a coward also. That's what that is very clear in Gita and in other instances also, Ramayana also, Mahabharata also.
See, we have made like the three types of Pramana. We have Pratyaksha and Anuman and Shabda Pramana. So Pratyaksha and Anuman, you can see from your eyes. Anuman, you can inference logic, which you do in most of the scientific experiments. You inference logic, where you put the past A to B to C, and is A to C, like there's no direct relationship, but you establish a relationship. That is a very commonly given logical platform. But the third one, the Shabda Pramana, because you have to start somewhere. And there are many things our eyes cannot see, which animals can see. There are many things we cannot hear, animals can hear. There are many things which we cannot smell, but the animals can smell. And they also have sometimes higher perception powers. Now, there is a very interesting story mentioned in Mahabharata, that when the population was increasing unlimited on this earth, just understand, the population control is not our responsibility. Devatas control it, because they have to make sure that it is livable. You know, so we always worried about population control. Our focus should be creating good population with good samskar and people who can actually add to the work of Brahma. Now, we should not create Ravana or Kansa or Duryodhana or Karna. We need to create good Sri Ram-like people, Hanuman-like people, and Bharat-like people, which were needed for the society. So the creation of Mrityu in red and black dress is the first creation to control the population. And to give a boon to them, the concept of, if they cannot finish your desires in one body, they'll do it in the next. So the Punarjan concept is also established for human beings by Brahma. Now, this is a very direct reference. Now, here in the case of animals, we see, you know, that's why in Hinduism, Sanatan Dharma, or Buddhism, the concept of reincarnation is very much established as a scientific fact. Because the animals are also considered part of the creation, and they also have equal rights. You know, when they talk about human rights, there's a lot of politics and money being made in the name of animal rights. But there is Sanatana Dharma is the only culture where we go all the way out to respect the life of the people, of including animals. What do you have to say on that?
No doubt about that. No doubt about that. God, see, this Gajendra Moksha is one of the greatest examples. Why, this tale is being told and so emphatically displayed. Both crocodile and elephant, those which is the cause of the pain and those the one which suffers from the pain, both can get liberated. And human being has not been chosen here. And as you said that, it's not that other gods, goddesses don't come to help. The Supreme God comes on his own, because one reason is that Gajendra is praying to him only. Now he wants liberation. He has been king, and he saw that even Agastya Rishi could not understand his situation, and he has cursed him when he was immersed in the prayer. So he is not reaching to anybody else. He is reaching to Supreme Consciousness and believing that he is part of that Supreme Consciousness. He calls, he prays, he remembers him, and he is rescued, he is liberated. And this is what is believed in our system.
Thank you so much, Rajesh ji. And I think many viewers would love it. And there are many questions, but some of them are not relevant, so I'm not going to take it up. And the one thing I must tell you, that the only scientific culture, scientific I'll say, because Vidya means science, And Vidya doesn't mean just knowledge. Vidya means the discrimination of right and wrong. So avidya is a very important concept here. So
yeah, there is in Upanishad, it is sa vidya ya bhumukte. It's not knowledge. Knowledge is you acquire.
Yeah.
But sa vidya, vidya is see. I mean, it's a feminine here. It liberates you.
That's right.
Which liberates you.
And from vidya comes gyan after you actually, you know, I'm more focused on vigyan here, because vigyan means little something beyond gyan. You actually realize what you're seeing. And sometimes, you know, you do not realize it, but we have to keep repeating it so that it starts establishing in our brains. And then we start seeing from gyan chakshu instead of netra chakshu. You know, so right.
Very right.
So we have to develop that vision. And one of the most beautiful stories of Bhagavatam, Gajendra Moksha, teaches so many things, different things. And especially the mantra that you said, Om Namo Bhagavate, where he is actually calling Bhagavan and no other devta comes except Hari. Because they all, he is calling that supreme person. That is the word he uses.
Yes. And he describes it. He goes on telling.
Goes on describing.
Sattva, rajasa, tamasa, all these guns are there. But you are also much more than this.
Correct.
So he describes God's what he has understood about him. And then he says, oh God, Bhagavan, you are beyond this. So please come. Please now rescue me and take me for salvation. For he's not talking about this small pain. I mean, that he could have survived. But he is now talking that let us move to another state, the state where my own Bhagavan rests in.
Yes, and the unlimitedness of the development that we have to do on ourselves. You know, people are looking to develop themselves or invest in themselves to uncharted territories. And this prayers in the 8th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, I can tell you the chapter number also, 4th chapter in the 8th canto. So you can 4th and 3rd and 6th, 5th, all three you can read. And the extent of human development is described by this person, Indradumna,
who is talking.
You know, the extent where you can go. So don't limit yourself. You know, this is an excellent place to unlimit yourself. And, you know, body is a limitation. I know you can think, cannot think beyond it. That's why you need teachers. Somebody who has seen beyond you. There are a lot of people get spiritually developed beyond their bodies. A lot of people are there. A lot of people. And so that's why they said, tad viddhi pranipatena pariprasena seveya. Gyaninas tattva darshan, who has that knowledgeable person who has tattva taken the darshan, or he has seen the truth. So thank you so much, Rajesh ji. Always a pleasure. And for all the viewers who are joining and commenting, thank you so much for doing that. And till next time, namaste and thank you. Be safe. Namaste.
Thank you and namaste to everybody.